Great Oaks Charter School here in Bridgeport, which I hear is a phenomenal school. What is your relationship with this school and how did that come about?
Again, you know, it's connecting to people. So when I talk about retiring from Bridgeport Hospital, the CEO of Silver Hill Hospital, which is a mental health, a psychiatric hospital in New Canaan, Connecticut, said, I want to help with this project. And he quickly went about forming a committee and called me up, or actually emailed me and said, I have a committee, we're ready to have a meeting. And I said, oh, I've got to call Deborah Cavanis of Bridgeport if I'm going to do anything. And so that's what I did. And Deborah is actually our community liaison. She's on the board now because we're officially a board. But she came up with a list of schools that we should visit. And Great Oaks was the second school we visited. The first school we visited was actually very interested in us, but the kids were actually a little bit young for the activities that we wanted to offer. Prior to the meeting with the Great Oaks staff, we had sent out questionnaires, and I had this very formal presentation, slides to talk about this stuff. I must have gotten 5 minutes into the thing where I decided, I don't need to have this conversation. They were so on board. They were saying, we're looking for something like this for our kids. This is exactly what we need, and you're willing to bring that here. We're all for it. And we have never worked, I have never personally, in all my professional years, worked with any group of people who, when you ask for something, their first response is, well, let's figure out how to do it if we don't know how to. But there's always a yes, and then we figure it out together. It's been a wonderful experience working with this group of folks.
Now, is this program only available to students who attend Great Oaks?
At this point, it is. We hope that we're going to get so big that we're going to be able to expand to other schools.
Now, applying psychology allows you to identify any issues, but after that point, how do you fix the problem? What is that process like?
So we are going in not so much as psychologists or psychiatrists. In fact, we do have a number of us there. And our goal is basically to get to the point before people develop problems. I'm sure there are kids there already identified who have problems with anxiety, for example, or trauma. And for those kids, what we would do is to refer so that we wouldn't actually take on providing any treatment there. There are social workers at the school who work, and the teachers there, that's the other thing that I have been so impressed with, is watching how teachers interact with kids at that school. There's a sense of respect. So, you know, when we say sabona means we see you, we actually see how the teachers, principals, see these kids in their entirety. And so it's, for me, it's been just a wonderful experience to partner with this group.
Why is counseling, therapy so taboo in our community?
So I think we've all grown up within our community saying you should always keep things private. You don't tell strangers what your problems were. Don't hang out your dirty linen. All of us grew up with some version of that. I think that part of what our job is to help to break down that stigma, that people of color can do therapy, can seek counseling, and especially men of color. Partly, I think we have to break down the barriers so that we actually meet people where they are, as opposed to waiting until they come to us. And I'm hoping that Sorbonne can model that. You know, one of the examples that I see is for prostate cancer, as opposed to having screening days at hospitals and clinics, they talk to men in black barbershops, because that's where men hang out and talk. I'm hoping for the day when we can do that with mental health for people of color, so that we don't have to come to a clinic, a hospital, or emergency room when you're in trouble, but it's a place where you can actually talk about, this is what I'm struggling with. because we all have some issues with which we struggle.
And why is your organization so important to the community?
I'm hoping that it will be important to the community in that it is hoping to build resilience, because that's really what we're going to focus on, so that kids, when they see me, don't think of me as a shrink. Somebody, you have to be crazy to talk to this person. I'm a regular person who is there helping them with dyeing a t-shirt, putting something on a mask, whatever. And they start to have conversations with you. They start to ask them, like, where are you from? Where did you go to school? And so you're doing more than a project together. You're really modeling for them how you can be in this world and address mental health at the same time.
Okay. Now, is it important for these kids in the inner city to talk to someone who looks like them and can identify with the struggle that they are going through?
I think it's important, but we also have the realization that there are not enough people of color in therapy. I think it's about something like 1% of psychologists are African American, and I think 3% psychiatrists. The numbers have not shifted very much. Social work is a little bit better. And so, yes, it's important, but I think there are also culturally competent people of different backgrounds who can work with them. And so I was very deliberate about the board that we chose. The board is multiracial, and also we all have different talents. And so I also want the kids to see that. Our volunteers are multiracial. And so, because you're gonna have to, you know, one of the things that Martin Luther King said is that we are all tied together in a garment of destiny. It's all of us together. When we think of trauma, we think of trauma that's happened intergenerationally, but also it's happening in our police officers who are black, white, Latina, whatever. It's happening in white communities that they have their own trauma. The healing has to be something that we work on together. There's a great book out there called My Grandmother's Hands by Resma Menakin that talks a lot about trauma and intergenerational trauma. And it would be great if we had, you know, enough black therapists and black physicians and to work in our community. We don't. And we're never going to get to that point. We're a small percentage of the population, but we have enough well-trained people who are culturally competent and people who are of goodwill. I think in the last few years, we've gotten so divisive that people are afraid of making a mistake. Is this a microaggression? What I tell my white friends is, make the mistake, apologize, but keep going, but don't hold back. And I think that's what we're gonna have to do, is to take some risk with people who don't necessarily look like us.
So do you have any advice for parents who may not know that their kid or their child is going through anything that may harm themselves? Any word or advice that we should be looking for?
A few things I would say. One is, try to sit down with your kids for meals. If you're driving your kids to some activity, take not just your kids, but their friends as well. You learn a lot at meal times driving your kids someplace. I think the other thing that we really have to pay attention to is the use of social media. Social media can offer some very positive things, but there are also a lot of negative things. And one of the things that we see is this contagion effect around mental health issues or suicide issues. We need to know what our kids are watching, and we need to pay attention to that. And I think as parents, some of us over the years have gotten very lax about doing that. So those would be the areas. I would say the other thing that you touch on, which is harming themselves, we have a tendency to not to want to talk about suicide, for example, or to ask the question, because we think that when you ask the question, you're putting the thought into someone's mind. In fact, you're not. What you're allowing them to do is to be comfortable discussing it. And I find this even among mental health professionals or actually other healthcare professionals, there's somewhat of a little bit of a hesitancy when you start out to ask the question. People are relieved that you can ask that question. Has things gotten so bad that you thought about hurting yourself? For example, it doesn't have to be you want to kill yourself. You know, it's a gradual approach, but it's a conversation that can be had.
How can the community support your vision in terms of volunteering and donation?
Okay, that's a great question. So the first thing I would say is to go to our website, which is sawbonacares.org, and that's S as in Sam, A-W-U-B-O-N-A, cares.org. It's one word. And you'll be able to contact us by email there. You can also write to us at P.O. Box 5837 here in Bridgeport, Connecticut, 06610. The kinds of volunteers that we're looking for, people who have any expertise in the arts, whether it's rap poetry, writing skills, dance, movement. We actually have art therapists on our group, but we always look for other people, music therapists, drummers, for example. We had a drum circle the other day with the staff. So we're always trying to find ways to have kids express themselves. In the next couple of weeks, we have ceramics coming up, so people who have experience in pottery, for example. And again, there's usually some directive so that they'd work with the curriculum team to design what it is that they want to do with the kids. And you can also go to that same website and you're able to donate online.
Okay. So is there any advice that you will offer to anyone who may be dealing with mental health issues?
Talk to someone. And there are several people that I would suggest you talk to. Sometimes family members don't understand, but your pastor usually is somebody, a trusted elder in your community, counselors. There are actually numbers now that you can call and speak to someone, not necessarily if you're suicidal. Important for people to talk. Most people end up feeling isolated and alone, that they're the only ones going through what they're going through, and it's much more common than we think.
All right, so we're gonna wrap it up, and I'd like to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to sit down here with us to talk about your organization, and we really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the opportunity. Right. Sawbona.
Thank you.